Hello Cloud Gurus, I'm Nigel Poulton, and welcome to Kubernetes This Month. And here's how we'll slice this. We'll do our usual roundup of the major news and events from the past month. We'll pick a couple of those and dive deeper, and we'll finish up with a chance for you to win a goodie bag through our Guru of the Month quiz. So, make yourself comfortable and get ready to enjoy. First up, on a non-technical note, KubeCon EU scheduled for the end of March in Amsterdam has been postponed in the interests of everyone's health and safety. The current word from the CNCF is that they're looking to reschedule around July or August time. And yeah, this is bang in the middle of holiday season for a lot of the world, but you know what? Pulling something together like this is no mean feat. Now, on core Kubernetes, betas or betas for 1.18 have hit the wild. Now, beta or beta means it's obviously early, and of course, we'll do a full inspection when it eventually goes GA. But looking through the enhancements tracker, endpoint slices might be in there as GA, and there's work going on around finally getting ingress into GA, though that might not arrive until 1.19. Now, sliding over to hosted Kubernetes, GKE's giving everyone more and more control over the hosted aspects of a GKE cluster. So, surge upgrades gives you control over how nodes are upgraded, and node locations lets you decide which zones in a region your nodes get deployed to. Now, looking at the bigger picture here, right, we're seeing a genuine or a gradual trend of GKE giving us more and more control over our hosted control plane, if you'll excuse the pun. Sticking with GKE, Google's brought back an old feature of sorts, right? And it's not a popular one. So after putting a smile on all of our faces a couple of years ago when they eliminated the control plane management fee, well, it's back. So as of June this year, a control plane management fee of 10 cents per cluster per hour will come into play. And I guess that means it's time for me to get a bit more experience with other hosted platforms. Though, Amazon already charges 10 cents per EKS cluster. Switching focus to service meshes, there was more discussion again this month over Google still not donating Istio to a foundation. Now, this story's been going on for a while now, but it came up again last month. Now, Google effectively owns 6 of the 10 seats on the Istio steering committee and is supposedly blocking moves to donate. So the question is, will this impact adoption of Istio in the long run, and is it a sign of turbulent times ahead for the open source community as large companies look for ways to make a profit? Sticking with service mesh, and on a slightly more positive note, LINKERD released version 2.7 with a strong security focus. Automatic rotation of TLS certs and integration of the TLS infrastructure with external PKI providers top the bill of features. Cillium released version 1.7 with a load of features, right? At least one of which we'll be talking about in the deeper dive section. KubeFlow announced a 1.0 release of the project that's dedicated to bringing the cloud to machine learning, or at least enabling machine learning engineers and applications to leverage cloud resources. The Docker index shows us some crazy stats for container adoption, and we'll talk about that as well in the deeper dive section, along with some findings from the latest StackRox container and Kubernetes security report. Now, also on the topic of security, hats off to Jeremy Gamblin for his hard work and his sleepless nights putting together scan.vulnerablecontainers.org. As the name suggests, it scans containers for known vulnerabilities. Right now, there's a couple of API endpoints, but more are coming in the future. So thank you, Jeremy. And last but not least, CoreOS Container Linux will officially go end of life at the end of March, meaning it won't be patched or otherwise updated. Now, Red Hat are suggesting users migrate to Fedora CoreOS, but I'd just like to place on record a sincere thanks to CoreOS Linux for pioneering lightweight Linux distros aimed at containerized apps. You know what? It was massively influential, and it can go to rest having accomplished some great work. And that wraps our news and events catch-up. Okay, in this month's deeper dive section, we'll look a bit closer at Cillium 1.7 and the replacement of KubeProxy, and also some amazing stats from Docker, tempered by some of the findings in the StackRox security report. Okay, first up, Cillium 1.7. Now, the announcement of this release seems to have a ton in it. I mean, there's updates to the Hubble UI, which helps you visualize and troubleshoot, which also they've open sourced. There's cluster-wide network policies that let you apply baseline network policies to the entire cluster, so crossing namespaces and everything sounds cool. And then there's replacing KubeProxy. So KubeProxy is a fundamental Kubernetes service that runs on every cluster node. It's mainly responsible for the networking magic, right, that gets traffic from a service's cluster IP to pods behind the service. Now, for context, right, it's recently had an overhaul replacing IP table stuff with IPvS. Think faster and more functionality. Anyway, that's not enough for everyone, including Cillium, who've got their own thing based on eBPF. Think even faster again. Now, look, don't get me wrong, networking is at the heart of most things, especially in a cloud-native microservices world. I mean, there will never be a situation where you've got too much performance and there'll never be an end to the fine-tuning you need to do. So, okay, why wouldn't we want the best possible solution? It's just that KubeProxy, for me, right, feels so core and so fundamental that switching it out for something more vendor-specific, even if it is better, I don't know, it scares me. As well as that, though, they've got this direct server return thing that gets around some of the limitations of normal Kubernetes services where, for example, okay, unnecessary network hops are sometimes incurred and we sometimes lose the original source IP. Again, it sounds pretty amazing what they're doing with this direct server return, but I don't know, right? Bringing non-standard behavior, even if it is better behavior, kind of scares me again. But you know what? Maybe I'm just not brave enough. And I will say this, it is cool stuff that they're doing. Okay then, Docker released some stats recently showing, well, just mind-blowing numbers. So Docker Hub is for sure the most popular container registry out there, and Docker Inc. have mined some anonymized stats showing the rate of container usage. So some headline numbers include over 130 billion, with a B, all-time container image pulls, and that's just from Docker Hub, right? And it's ratcheting up at a current rate of 8 billion a month and growing. There are 5 million Hub users and around 2.5 million installations of Docker Desktop, which, if you don't know, okay, will run a local Kubernetes cluster on your laptop for you. Now, okay, this is fabulous and all, and it really is, but apparently it could be even more. You see, according to the latest StackRox Container and Kubernetes survey, security concerns over containers have caused just under half of survey respondents to delay deploying into production. 94% of respondents, okay, have experienced a security-related incident in their container environments in the last year. Now look, I don't want to be spreading fear here. I imagine a lot of them have also experienced security incidents in their non-container environments as well. Though, of the security incidents in question, over 60% were apparently due to misconfigurations rather than code vulnerabilities. Sounds like they need to train their people up. I wonder where they could do that. Anyway, oh yeah, over 60% also cited a skills gap or a steep learning curve as a major inhibitor to deploying containers. Sounds like they could do with some Kubernetes video training courses. But you know what? I think this wraps up our deep dive. Loads of container adoption, right? But it could be even more if we had more skills and more security. Okay, Guru of the Month. Last month, I asked which container runtime was based on the core container runtime from the Docker project, and the correct answer was container D. Now, let me tell you, okay? Every answer that we got was excellent. No joke. In fact, I couldn't choose a winner, so I flipped some coins. And the coin said, Kartik Kumar, you are our winner this month. Kartik is a DevOps engineer from Bangalore in India, congratulations, we'll be sending you a goodie bag. Now, like I said, right, massive thanks to everybody else. Your answers were immense and I could have picked any of them. Anyway, thanks for getting involved. This month's question is in the forum link below. And as always, I'll see you again next month. Same Kube time, same Kube place.